I'm just going to talk about a Delphi study that we're doing to develop a service framework at a high level to inform the delivery of children's mental health services in the region. This study is only partway through, and so I'm talking about standing at the bottom of the impact mountain and looking up, because I'm going to very much talk about what we're planning to do. Hopefully next year I'll be able to come back and tell you what we did and how successful we were in doing that. But this is really about the pathways to impact that we're mapping out to ensure that we can move from consensus, because this is a Delphi study, to commissioning. So in my 15 minutes, I'm going to be quick. Then I'm going to give some background to the study. Then I'm going to talk about the aim, the method, and the progress that we've made so far. Then I'm going to talk about the pathways to impact. And then I'm just going to focus a little bit on some of the challenges that we've experienced in engaging with service providers in the region and the relevance of that when we're thinking about impact. So the context to this study is that, you know, there's been a huge focus on the delivery of mental health services over the last couple of years, and report after report has really concluded that services need to be redesigned and reorganised in order to simplify the system, to simplify commissioning arrangements, to improve access, and to ensure that we can do more without a big injection of extra funds, really, particularly around prevention and early intervention. And the latest shiny policy report that's come out really concludes the same and sets out a national vision for the transformation of mental health services. But it also calls for the development of local transformation plans to translate that national vision into local action. And they're very specific about the need to co-produce those plans with different stakeholder groups, so children, parents, and service providers. So this is great news for us. This couldn't have been better timing, because our Delphi study is aiming to canvass the opinions of stakeholder groups within the region about what services should look like, with the aim of defining the aims and characteristics of a community service-based model, and to really identify those areas of service delivery that people agree are important. And that might only be a handful of features. I hope not, but it might only be. And also to identify those areas where agreement can't be reached and potentially identify barriers to innovation. So the method that we're using is a Delphi method, and that's a particularly helpful way of reaching consensus in an area where there are quite disparate opinions, and also where there may be a perceived power differential by the people that are feeding into the process. And both apply here, because we're working with service providers, some of them who are clinicians, parents and children. So the study consists of three rounds. So the first round is the opinion gathering round. So we've been talking to the different stakeholder groups using different methods, and we've essentially constructed a long wish list of ideas about how services should be delivered. Round two is about distilling that list into a questionnaire and asking people to rate the importance of each of those ideas on the collective list. And round three is the consensus building round, and what we do there is we give back the questionnaire, but this time we offer feedback about what everybody in the group said, what the collective opinion was around each of those ideas, and we remind people of what they said last time. And that encourages convergence between the individual's opinion and the group opinion, and hopefully what drops out of the bottom of it is some consensus around particular service features. We're adapting the method a little bit in this instance, because we want to keep the views of parents and children at the heart of the process. And so we're providing feedback to professionals about the group opinion of parents and children. So in terms of the progress that we've made so far, then we've spoken to 29 children and young people aged between 8 and 21, 24 parents and 115 professionals from various sectors. We try to kind of reach far and wide. We have an overrepresentation of some groups and an underrepresentation of others, but we've done our best. So we've looked at the ideas, we've done some analysis, and the ideas that have been put forward essentially coalesce under these key themes. Of course, not all of the ideas that are on the list are going to make it into the consensus statement. But I think, the stuff that is outside of the consensus statement is almost going to be as interesting, if not more, than the things that people agree on. And potentially we can identify those barriers that are presenting difficulties to changing services. But in terms of what we intend to do with the results of this study, then obviously we want to do the, have the traditional academic outputs. It's good for everyone's CV. But we're particularly interested in informing the commissioning process. And this idea was initially conceived of through conversations between Peter and between commissioners in the area around the need for evidence to inform the commissioning process, and also with acknowledgement of the competing priorities of different stakeholder groups. So this is a pared-down commissioning cycle that people will be familiar with, and we should have information to offer to each stage of the process, but we're particularly interested in this first instance in working with commissioners to use the evidence to create the shared vision of service provision, and hopefully what will drop out of that is commissioning priorities that are shared across different sectors. And that's particularly important as there's, an ever-increasing move towards joint commissioning of services. So how are we going to do that? Because we do have a really receptive context for this kind of study. There's a push from national policy, but there's also a pull from local commissioners. But it's not enough to hope that we can float out the findings and that they're somehow going to affect change in service delivery. And at some level, the study in and of itself is a kind of engagement exercise. We've spoken to huge hundreds of people, actually, about taking part in the study. I'd like to say that only 20% took us up on the offer. So we've constructed a kind of a network through which we can disseminate the results of this study, but that alone isn't going to affect the change that that we're hoping for, the impact that we're hoping for. So we've done a couple of things. We are engaging with three kind of existing networks or program boards who are working around the development of child and adolescent mental health services. And they are really serving as to offer some study oversight, but also as critical friends. And they've been important in feeding into the design process around the study. And it's their intention to use the evidence that we're generating to inform their strategy and their work plans going forwards. We're also interested in assembling a group of senior decision makers to be able to, with the explicit intention of translating the consensus statement into shared priorities, a shared vision and shared priorities. The challenge here, and I've had a conversation with Aidan Thomas, the chief exec of CPFT today, is that we need to make the research timescales fit with the commissioning timescales. And Aidan has told me that actually that these results could have been done with being generated yesterday, and so we're really feeling a little bit like the Eeyore to the commissioner's Tigger at the moment, which is a nice place to be, but hopefully we won't miss the boat. And then finally, we are not the only people in the region doing this kind of work because of the policy context. It's so warm. And so we hope that we've identified an opportunity to be able to synthesize the results of this study with similar studies going on in the region to kind of provide a broader regional perspective. Because try as we might, our study is very Cambridgeshire and Peterborough centric, really. So that all looks like a nicely thought through plan. It looks like we might have done it prospectively, but actually it's kind of evolved over time. It's been a lot more of an organic process, and we have kind of developed these ideas as we've embarked on the study, and we've been talking to different people about it. And so, it's a little bit messier. But I think in truth, that probably is reflective of a lot of people's kind of impact strategy. But I also want to, while I'm being truthful, talk to you about some of the challenges that we've faced when we've been trying to engage with service providers to take part in this study. So we've needed to recruit over 100 service providers, but we've also needed their help as gatekeepers to get in touch with parents and children to take part too. And as it's been raised through the day, service providers don't always want to take part in research, and we need to kind of acknowledge why that might be, and we've talked about some of the reasons already. So some of the things that I've heard are this is just duplication of what's already happened. So there's been quite a lot of effort to consult with different stakeholder groups within the region, and this just feels like it's duplication. It doesn't matter that I've kind of, this offers something new about developing consensus. Try as I might, I haven't been able to persuade everybody that this isn't just another focus group, albeit a posh one, which is what someone told me. So we need to acknowledge, as academics, that in our world, replication is a thing. Outside academia, not so much of a thing. It sometimes feels like just duplicated effort. And particularly when people are grappling with not having enough resource, then they're not quite sure of the value. Then we've heard, and we've heard today, that it doesn't always feel like something happens in the wake of a research study. And maybe that's because people haven't waited the full 17 years to identify the impact. But that's certainly been a barrier to taking part for some people. And this is someone reflecting on a previous research study where it felt like nothing had happened. And then we've spoken to some people, some important service providers in Cambridgeshire, actually, who are just saying, you know, actually, there's enough evidence now, we've consulted enough, we just need some funds and we just need to get on with it. But the interesting point there is it depends, you know, what we need to do depends on who you're speaking to. So highlighting the need for this study and the competing priorities, but it's been difficult to engage people where they feel that actually, we've got to a point of diminishing returns and we don't need to do anything else. And then there's the group of people that have been worried about asking parents and children what types of services they want in case they ask for the moon on a stick. So in case they ask for really expensive solutions that are just not feasible. And actually, that's not panning out. So what we see is the most common theme that parents and children identify is that they'd like professionals to listen to them and to validate them. So that's pretty cost neutral. And the final thing that people have expressed to us is a suspicion about why we're doing the study and what the hidden agenda might be. So they're working, people, there's a kind of culture of low morale at the moment, people are struggling, and they're wondering whether this is just a mechanism to justify further funding cuts and whether there is some kind of hidden agenda there. So, in terms of what that means, I think probably if you're thinking about some of those issues, then that means that we might have done a better job of communicating initially about the purpose of the study and the value that it might bring. But it does allow us to kind of foresee some of the issues going forwards, and it enables us to tailor our communication about the results of the study to head off some of those issues and address them. So that's where we are at the moment. We're stood at the bottom of the impact mountain looking up, and hopefully next year what I'll be able to tell you is about the view from the top, and hopefully I would have had lots of KPIs to put on the CLAHRC database.
Thank you very much, Emma.